Good morning, everyone. It's Matthias Chang once again from Future Fast Forward, speaking to all of you from my inner sanctum. Before going to my address, may I take this occasion to wish all my Chinese friends, colleagues, and patriots a happy Chinese New Year. May I wish you prosperity, good health, and victory for the coming 2017. Now, before I go to the substance of my address, the main feature, I have good news to announce to all of you, and this again illustrates that God works in mysterious ways. First and foremost, it has been announced that Soros has lost $1 billion following the election of Donald Trump as President of USA. You recall some weeks ago, I gave and I sent out WhatsApp messages and SMS messages to all of you, whereby I warned you that all the hedge funds, investors, private equity funds, banks, you name it, governments, have priced their trades, their investment on the basis that Clinton was swept the US general elections, and that there's no way Donald Trump will win. And if Donald Trump will win, the market will crash. All right? And some took the contrary trade. And I advise everyone that because everyone has priced for Clinton's victory, the election of Donald Trump will surprise everyone. And we must therefore take that into account. And sure enough, Soros, in his arrogance, bet against Trump and lost $1 billion. And I said many people like him would have lost billions all over the world. And that was the reason why, after the collapse of the market upon the election of Trump, all these fat cats has to push up the market to recover their losses. And I think some of them have yet to recover those losses. Be that as it may, I will now move on to another issue, breaking news, in that Donald Trump has done two fantastic things on his first day of his presidency. He issued two executive orders, one to defund climate change, and secondly, to revoke the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, TPPA. I will address that issue much more later in my main address. At this stage, I would like to draw your attention to the statement by the Prime Minister on GST last week, and invited all of us, if we disagree with GST, to come forward with better alternatives to that new tax regime. My rebuttal and reply is very simple. There's no need to provide an alternative to GST because all these years, from independence to now, we did not have or need GST because our economy was well managed. And the normal tax regime of income tax and sales tax was more than sufficient to cover the needs of our country. And you will recall that the height of the 1997-1998 ASEAN financial crisis, when the speculators, financial rapists, currency traders attacked Malaysia and tried to bring our country to its knees, under the able leadership of Tun Mahathir, we recovered and we did not impose any additional tax. That will be enough to rebut the statement by the Prime Minister. But more importantly, I want to show you a table of figures which will show that GST was required was because of the leakages, corruption, wastage, and extravagance by the Prime Minister. Now, here is a table of figures. All right? How much the Prime Minister's Office, PMO, or the Prime Minister's Department took part, a huge chunk of the budget. The table starts from 206 at the time of Patla's regime, whereby 4.2 billion was asked for to manage the PMO, representing 2.67% of the budget. When Najib took over in 2009, the budget for the Prime Minister's Office shot up to 30.9 billion, almost double from the year 2008 when Pak La increased from 4 billion in 2006 to 6.8 billion. All right? And now, last year, 2016, the budget of the Prime Minister's Office shot up horrendously to 20.3 billion, representing 7.6% of the total budget. All right? And this figure exceeds the development expenditure for national security, for our defense, which was about 5.0 billion. Okay? Having brought to your attention those figures, may I say that rather asking us for an explanation, an alternative, we should, as citizens of this country, demand from our Prime Minister, as well as Finance Minister, to account for every cent that he has spent since 2009, when the budget of the Prime Office exploded beyond imagination. And we need to know how every cent, S-E-N, has been spent, where, how, and when. Because GST now is required to offset this extravagance, the prostitution of our country to foreign power like China, and demand investments via what, MDB, SRC, FGV, and what have you. And I hope all of you, in one voice, all the riot, all patriots, will demand the accountability for the Prime Minister for this horrendous, horrendous budget misallocation. The other thing I want to draw your attention is, last week, or rather 2 weeks ago, Najib announced with much fanfare his grand vision 2050, without anything to substantiate his vision. And I said that that vision is propaganda, pure soundbite, all thunder and no rain. All thunder, no rain. And so, last Thursday, our Prime Minister decided to give some content to that vision and hauled the young punk, Khairy to his sidekick to have a town hall meeting at the University of Malaya with some 500 youngsters on the basis of a shared vision. His 2050 is a shared vision, all right? Thereby, indirectly and sarcastically saying that 2020 vision of Tun Mahathir and our country for the last 30 years was not a shared vision, whereas his 2050 was a shared vision. Let me say, 2050 is merely an excuse, a wayang kulit, a drama to cover up and divert his failure to fulfill the vision and objective of 2020. Since 2003, on the onset of the Pala regime, we had 17 years to fulfill that vision. It failed. And Najib promised that he will fulfill it. In 2013, by 218, 2 years in advance. And now he can't do it, so he had to divert. Interestingly, as reported in the Star newspaper, the Nation section on Friday, 20th January, reporting on what happened day before, Thursday, 19th January, the key paragraph, which I want to highlight to you, is very simple. You expose the hollowness, the emptiness, and more importantly, the failure of Najib himself, of the critical facts, and the lies and the cover-up. He said that when he was young, he went to school by bicycle, and he had to cycle from Sri Perdana to Tanlin Hospital to buy some nasi lemak. And I quote, "I remember the old man who sold nasi lemak to my foreign friends, this is right, rice with spice, anchovies, what have you, under the cherry tree for 30 cent, S-E-N. But if you wanted the sotong and daging, squid and meat, it cost 50 cent. But that's in the past," he says. "Things have changed today, and this is a reminder we've come a long way," implying now we are now in a bed of roses, the bad times and poverty no longer apply. What a short memory. For you recall 3 weeks ago, a young lady who graduated as an electrical engineer was unemployed and pressed by desperation for survival, started to sell nasi lemak. And of course, in a stupid way, the Prime Minister praised her for being entrepreneurial in selling nasi lemak, as opposed to the horror and an honesty, if he was honest, to admit that his process failed. Young people are unemployed and have to sell nasi lemak to survive. Therefore, the present time is not an improvement of the previous years when nasi lemak was 30 cents and graduates was held in high esteem and could get jobs without any problems. In fact, people from the villages, from the kampong, will come to the convocation to celebrate the honor and pride that a child from their village has attained high achievement. But today, we have paper mills giving useless degrees, and even if you have a good degree, there are no jobs. She is but one of the many thousands unemployed, struggling for survival. And you recall in my previous address, I said that graduates, young students, had to enroll in colleges to study, to improve themselves, and had to borrow money and end up as a debt slave from the day they entered college and to start work as a debt slave. And this is a situation, horrendous. But he tried to wipe that image, wipe that failure and say, she's entrepreneurial. She couldn't even apply her electrical engineering knowledge to her advantage. She had to sell a nasi lemak. And then in the Star newspaper, they highlighted seven young people in this orchestrated town hall meeting. Okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The six of them gave the usual statements as aspirations, nothing new whatsoever, because if these were news-making statements, innovative statements, right, then I would expect to be highlighted. But they were talking about the mundane stuff. Surely, Khairy, as the youth minister, ought to know from Data Bank in his ministry, other ministries, with all this information as to the problems and aspirations of the young people for the future. But zilk, nothing. You will recall that in 2003, when Patla came to power, Khairy was in the administration. He was 27 years young. In 2009, he was elected as head of UMNO Youth, head of Pemuda UMNO. He was then 33 years young. All right? I was told he was elected, he was elected together in, was competing with Ker Toyo, the MB of Selangor, and Dr. Murkis. He won. And then 3 years ago in 2013, he was elevated as Minister of Youth, 37 years young. So close to 14 years, his sole attention, focus, and responsibility was youth. Yet, after all these years, does he require a town hall meeting, a wayak kulit, a drama in the Isle of Malaya town hall meeting, asking for some feedback? Rubbish. And the comment by one of the youngsters, in fact, he's not a youngster, he's 29 years old, a so-called environmentalist by the name of Rashwin Palsing. His comment at that town hall reflects the quality of education wherever he obtained, whether locally or overseas, and his inability to be a discerning scientist. This is what he says. My aspiration for TN50 is for Malaysia to be a carbon neutral, if not carbon negative country. A minimum quota of forest reserves and for a higher adoption of renewable energy as the main power source. I'm quite sure he doesn't understand his own terminology. Carbon neutral, if not carbon negative. Carbon negative means no carbon emission. Negative. Minus. Any secondary school student will tell you, intellectual bankrupt Rashmin, carbon dioxide is critical to agriculture, to plant, to photosynthesis. So how can you therefore aspire and to impose carbon neutral or carbon negative when the agriculture is in open space, occupied thousands of acres in plantation land, thousands of acres of paddy fields where carbon dioxide is critical to agriculture. Can you see how stupid he is? And he has been highlighted with prominence in a Star newspaper. See his face? Okay? Now this kind of rubbish about preparing for the future, for 2050. Having said that, let me now tell you something about how policies are formulated, not only for the present, short-term, mid-term, and also for the future. In my last address, I exposed and drew your attention on development economics and highlighted the excellent work of the professor of economics in LSC, Ha Jun Chang, who wrote the book Kicking Away the Ladder. And last week, I WhatsApped and SMS to all of you, please watch two videos which I've uploaded to my website. First, a speech by Ha Jun Chang regard to his book Bad Samaritans, alright, his second book, The Myth of Free Trade and the secret history of capitalism. And give history as illustration, Toyota and other companies, and as well as Singapore, okay? How development economics should be applied and not adopt what they say and not what they do. And then there was a second video of professors and LSE in a debate. Too much math, too little history in economics. The problem economics. These are the leading lights of LSE, London School of Economics. And they were indulging in intellectual masturbation, if I may use the expression. Save Professor Hajun Chang and his colleague proposing and in support of that motion. Too much math, too little history, the problem economics. All bunkum. And I also recall, as some time ago, in my article, in my previous speech, I invited all of you to Google why the Queen asked the leading economists in LSE why they can't foresee and prevent the 2008 financial tsunami. And why, as a result, she lost over 70 million pounds. It was reported that those big wigs in economics, said, well, I don't know. I rely on the other fella to know what it's about and to warn us. And the second fella said, I don't know really. And I rely on the third economist. What's happening? Blind, leading the blind. So, therefore, where we must be very careful when we talk about economic policies, not only for the present situation in our country, but also the future. And to illustrate this point, I drew your attention once again, those armchair critics, pseudo-intellectuals, no otak, who whack to Mahathir and his policy, especially on Proton, and talk rubbish without even doing any research, especially historical research, and make all kinds of statements. One of them is Ms. Ng In Sin, the COO of ASLI, the think tank. And it was an article published in the Free Malaysia Today and other social media as well. And there she said that, right, we should do away with Proton because Proton has drained too much of the natural resources, all right, and there's a lot of wastage, and therefore Proton is past its sunset time and must be done away with. Let me say this article, all right, if it is an answer to an examination paper on development economics or on the product industry, will fail. Will not even master the bare minimum marks to skip through the examination. All generalities. Because it's a reference to Proton. I would have thought a person with that qualification, holding that position as CEO of a think tank, would at least in that article make reference to day one of Proton. Alright? Now let me tell all of you, Proton was conceived by Thun before 1983. He researched, he studied, he analyzed, and then in 1983, the company Proton was established. And in 1985, 2 years later, the factory was up and running and producing cars. Now I have a tabulation of figures, okay? Most importantly, you will notice in 1988, some 3 years later of production, under the management of the Japanese, we suffered a loss of 80 million. Thereafter, okay, production went up, profit went up. But Proton, under the superb and brilliant leadership of Tunku Bahalil, from the end of 95 to 2002, Proton grew by leaps and bounds, and in 2002 achieved 1.5 billion profit. You will recall down below 2003, 2004, 2005, still under the management of Tunku Mahathir, things, production was not as much, but the profit was still there. Performance went down a bit because when Pala took over in 2003, effort was made to scuttle Proton, to destroy the legacy of Tunku Mahathir. And then the rot really started from 2006, 2007, and 2008 under this misguidance, the lousy leadership of Dato' Azlan. 2007, massive losses, 6.8 million. Okay? Because 2007, he may give the excuse that 2007 was a financial crisis. But Mahathir in 1998, facing similar crisis, asked for no bailout, had profits, then very well, 724 million. Okay? The rot started with Patla, with the mismanagement, and from then on, Proton went down the drain, the tubes. Okay? And you will recall, the same idiot sold a key subsidiary of Proton, Agusta Motorbikes, the Rolls Royce of motorbike, for ringgit or $1. Subsequently, I was told, I stand to be corrected, it was resold for at least 100 million euros. Because once you scuttle, you destroy the crown jewel of our country, the crown jewel of the Bumiputra community, it'd be very difficult to recover. At the same time, Perdua was doing well. How many knew that Perdua was approved by Tun Mahathir? A Malaysian company, aligned with, assisted by Toyota. Perdua went up because Proton was destroyed. You see? But if you say both are Malaysian company, why not destroy Perdua? And just concentrate on Proton. Because that was a major legacy of Tun Mahathir Mohamad. Now, further information for you. This chart shows the cash reserve and pre-tax profit of Proton from the time and during the time of Tunku Mahathir, 1995, 2002. Brilliant performance, cash reserves, okay? After Tunku Mahathir stepped down, and under the misguidance of Dato' Azlan, the cash reserve disappeared. Another graph shows that Proton was the largest company and the largest contributor to research and development. Okay? The year 1998 to 1999, 639 million. 99 to year 2000, 734 million. 2001, 944 million. 2001 to 2002, 608 million. 2002 to 2003, 1.4 billion. In research and development, no other company in Malaysia came close to Proton. If Proton was not successful, it could not have spent so much money on research and development. Now, talking about Ng Yi Sin says about sunset clause and to do away with government aid. This data tells the whole story. When Proton was established, there was a 25-year loan of 400 million. First 5 years, no interest. next 20 years at 4% interest. And this loan was fully repaid 5 years in advance, okay, before the due date. There were tariffs, subsidies, 30% import and 50% excise duties. That's been done away with. Likewise, pioneer status, 10 years, that also has been done away with. And Proton, scumbag critics, scumbag hollow intellectuals, Proton is not the only industry or car company that had such subsidy or such aid from the government. Please, don't single out Proton, all right? And then, Ng Yi Sin says, it's a drain on resources of the government. Here, the pie chart shows the Proton from 1995 to 2002 gave to the government and the Rakyat of Malaysia 13.14 billion, comprising of 54% excise duty, 8% import duty, 5% corporate tax, and 33% sales tax. These are revenue generated by Proton to the government. All right? Until everything was scattered and went down the slippery slope of degradation. Here are pictures of some of the cars designed by Malaysian engineers, which was ready for production, but scuttled. Okay? Beautiful cars for domestic market and export market. These are further pictures of cars to be produced as well as motorbike when Augusta was part of a company subsidiary in the stable of Proton. That was discarded. Alright? And before he was forced out of office, Tunku Mahathir already had a blueprint to enhance the performance of Proton from 2003 to 2008. These are the figures. Investments for Proton. Because he was ousted and Proton was scuttled, all these plans were laid to waste. So for those critics of Mahathir and Proton, have you forgotten Proton saga? Kanchil were the best sellers, capturing 50%, 53% or more of the market share. We were so proud. A small country like Malaysia, making waves in the world in car manufacturing. Singapore, they not even venture to that market. Neither did China until recently, when they began to support local industry like the cherry. But Tun Mahathir was way, way in advance of everyone. Alright? He did not follow Washington consensus, but developed a policy that was suitable to our resources, our potential, our strength, the Malaysian body spirit, and the Malaysian economy. That's why I drew the attention and I quoted of all the economists, Ha Jun Chang, a South Korean, comes from an illustrious family. A brother's a minister, another brother a scientist. And if you Googled his bio data, you will realize that only in 1991, the Ha Jun Chang obtained his PhD. Yet, Proton was established in 1983, adopting an independent policy that set Malaysia on the path of industrialization. Only when he went to college did Ha Jun Chang realize the lies, the distortion, the propaganda of all those Western professors and lecturers as to what is required for developed countries to excel in development economics. So he was way behind. Way, way behind. Now he realized, excuse me, the correctness of Tun Mahathir is now in the forefront and a leading authority on develop economics. Compare Ha Jun Chang and Tun Mahathir. Wisdom, experience, older and younger. Two, Najib, lack of wisdom, older, but not necessarily wiser, younger, living in a world of illusion. Najib and Khairy. And Najib says he chose Khairy because he represents the youth and therefore should be able to be in tune with the youth. How silly. How silly. Look at Mahathir, and I'm sure all of you, never cross your mind, all of you, that Tun Mahathir retired in 2003. By July this year, Tun Mahathir will be 92 years old. He's been retired for almost 17 years. A grandfather, critic, condemned as an old man without energy, you know, losing his mind, senile. But you recall last Saturday at the launch and inauguration of the Bersatu Party in the stadium in Shah Alam, jam-packed, when he spoke, the young people rose up and shouted in one loud, clear voice, Hidup Mahathir! Hidup Mahathir! And when Mahathir said that he would guarantee that when the opposition came to power, GST will be repealed, buang, they all shouted in any unison in support of Tun Mahathir. Can you see? You don't have to be a youth to be in tune with the youth and the aspiration. Mahathir inspired and led the youth last Saturday to aspire to the heights of excellence, to do what's right, to follow a path of growth and positivity. Yet, we have a situation where someone comes up with a vision 2050, all hollow, or thunder, no rain, and say, in the next 3 years, we will get more data, blah, blah, blah. Can you imagine? But with an analogy, a field marshal, a great general, tasked by the nation to defend the country, to prepare for war in defense of the country. Do you think the general, the field marshal, and the entire defense staff who have to plan a strategy, tactics, marshal all the resources for that great battle, need to consult the corporal, the private, the sergeant? Of course not. The job and responsibility of the leader is to formulate strategy, tactics and plans. But of course there will be instances and situations whereby they may need to have consultation with the lowest level in the rank and file. But it's not the general practice. The leader with all the data, all the resources in his hands, and his colleagues and advisors will formulate the vision, the plan, the strategy and tactics. And then, through the process of osmosis, train everyone with one voice, united in one vision to implement that plan. Improvise, adapt, feedback, improvise again. That's how you do it. Here you have sound bites, one town hall dialogue, right? Which achieved nothing. Or they can summarize, as in a star, seven, this must be the cream de la cream commands, because they chose seven, of which six have nothing useful to contribute. And the last talk about negative carbon or neutral carbon, flush it down the toilet, okay? Let's move on. let's move on. Now, I want to give two facts that will provoke the young to move away from the misleading vision or path of Najib and Khairy. Believe you me, at the earliest 2020, at the latest 2025, 40% of graduates will have no jobs. 60% of faculties of all the universities in Malaya, at the earliest 2025, not earlier, at the latest 2030, will be made redundant. And this dire scenario will be expedited. Why? Excuse me, because Najib, the Prime Minister, Najib, the wasteful Finance Minister, has cut expenditure to all the universities. Already, lecturers, professors on contract have their contract terminated. When that happens, when there's no resources to teach, there's no department to enroll the students. When there's no students to be enrolled in that department for that course, they can't graduate and seek employment in that discipline. In fact, most of the courses now are redundant. Our universities are nothing but glorified in many ways. Paper mills, and the degrees are toilet paper degrees. This is a dire situation, okay? And I hope this will wake you up, young people, to be more realistic and avoid the illusion, the sound bites of 2050. Now I will come to why it's so important not to forget the contribution, the legacy, the intellectual legacy of Tun Mahathir. Okay? What is important is not the buildings, the ports, the airports, the universities. It's his brain, his mind, his intellectual legacy, and how he applied those legacies to concrete situation. Therefore, if I may, to borrow the research of Ha Jun Chang, which corroborates Tun Mahathir's wisdom, I'd like to read to you those passages which highlights how rich countries really become rich. How did rich countries really become rich? The short answer to this question is that the developed countries did not get where they are now through the policies and institutions that they recommend to developing countries today. Most of them actively use bad trade and industrial policies. Now they call them bad, but they were using it before, such as infant industry protection and export subsidies. Practices that these days are frowned upon, if not actively banned by WTO, World Trade Organization. Remember Frederick List, which I referred to in my last address, 1789 to 1846, is commonly known as the father of infant industry argument, namely, the view that in the presence of more developed countries, backward countries cannot develop new industries without state intervention, especially tariff protection. His masterpiece, The National System of Political Economy, was originally published in 1841, and for which in my last address, I showed to you the three volumes. List argues that Britain was actually the first country to perfect the art of infant industry promotion, which in his view is the principle behind most countries' journey to prosperity. Hence, they sought by a system of restrictions, privileges, and encouragements to transplant onto their native soil the wealth, the talents, and the spirit of enterprise of the foreigners. It's a very common clever device that when anyone has attained the summit of greatness, he kicks away the ladder by which he has climbed up in order to deprive others of the means of climbing up after him. In this lies the secret of the cosmopolitical doctrine of Adam Smith, who wrote The Wealth of Nations, and of the cosmopolitical tendencies of his great contemporary, William Pitt, and of all his successors in the British government administrations. And thereafter, we were subject to brainwashing by all these Western professors and lecturers who preached to other nations the benefits of free trade and who declare in penitent tones that she has hitherto wandered in the paths of error, has now for the first time succeeded in discovering the truth. Finally, USA is but a carbon copy of Britain, industrial and trade policies. When its industrial supremacy became absolutely clear after the Second World War, the USA was no different from the 19th century Britain in promoting free trade, despite the fact that it acquired such supremacy through the nationalistic use of heavy protection. Presently, President Trump is using the same strategies to make America great again after the Obama-Clinton cabal hollowed out American manufacturing and industrial capacities to Mexico under NAFTA, China, South Korea, India, etc., to other trade agreements. You will recall last few pages that I mentioned the concept of the West, different countries, kicking away the ladder, in Chinese with a similar expression. Go qiu lai ban. Once more, go qiu lai ban. Meaning, those who have crossed the bridge attain wealth, expertise, technology, then destroy the bridge. Go qiu lai ban. In Korea and other countries, the similarity is, and the analogy is, climbing up the ladder to the peak of success and then kicking away the ladder. And because of the stability of American leadership, Trump now is saying we must protect our industries again, buy America, buy American products, create American jobs, America first. There's protection. From now, the most powerful country in the world. And on the first day, as I stated at the beginning of my address, the first day of his presidency, he has signed two executive orders. One, revoking TPPA, Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which was one of the master plan, right, to isolate, to blockade China in trade, because TPPA excludes China. So Donald Trump has done China a big favor, revoked TPPA, and yet China and Xi Jinping do not understand the strategy of Trump and make provocative and declare they're really going to war with Trump, when Trump has done them one of the biggest favor, demolish TPPA and the economic blockade against China. So wake up, Chinese people in China, wake up Xi Jinping. And for the young punk pseudoscientist environmentalists, the pulsing a negative neutral carbon, Trump has signed an order, all right, defunding any more allocations to climate change research, okay? And I challenge any professor, any lecturers in this area to debate with me. And I expose the hoax of global warming and climate change. By the way, climate change every day, okay? It's a big, big business. If this hoax is exposed, a lot of professors, lecturers will be out of job, okay? And more interestingly, fossil fuel is the main cause of carbon dioxide emissions. Funny, how come no one tell the Muslim countries, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Kuwait, Iraq, the main producing countries of oil, Stop your oil production. No. So, you Muslim scholars, you see, how come it didn't occur in your mind? How come it didn't occur in your mind? No one dare tell the Arabs to stop production. That itself is a warning, is an indication that climate change, carbon emission is bullshit. Okay? It's a real threat. They would have gone after the Arabs. Okay? So with that, I will pause here for a while and I'll continue more on my next address. But as usual, may I remind all of you, please, we can't win this war. We can't expose the hypocrisy, the lies, the propaganda, unless, and I said before, God works in mysterious ways. So we have to surrender our will to God Almighty, to Allah, completely. No half measures. To have absolute faith that He will protect us, defend us, and guide us under all circumstances in the face of all enemies, adversities, and challenges. And based on these very broad principles and strategy and mindset, I can assure you we will have victory, and 2017 will be a great year for Riot and for Malaysia. With that, I wish you a good day and God bless. Thank you.